personalities for New Year's Eve 1990. Maurice Starr's name is appropriate. He claims he can make anyone a star, and the last thing anyone needs is talent. And as we showed you in September, he knows of what he speaks. Starr pulled the new kids on the block off the streets of Boston and turned them into the hottest teen group in the country. And to hear him tell it, he's only just begun. Maurice Starr, the man with his finger on the pulse of the American teenager, is our cover story.
I choose what the people want. Step by step. It looks like every person that I put out, you know, will never stop being a star. Ooh, baby. So it makes me look good. Looks like I have a magical touch. You're always on my mind. Now that I'm $100 million more richer, thank you. I still say thank you. Step by step.
Maurice is making no apologies for his success. In fact, he's sitting on top of the world. After all, Maurice is the cunning creator behind this musical monster. Starr is a commanding figure. He calls himself the General, and he has the demeanor of a circus ringmaster. But despite all the gimmickry, Starr's young prodigies seem to believe in him.
We're in show business, and that's what it's all about, you know, being having all this on and having, you know, something fun to, you know, play with, and it's just fun. He's given me an opportunity to, you know, entertain millions and millions of people, but and I thank him for that.
Starr plucked the new kids out of some of Boston's rougher neighborhoods. He admits they were only marginally talented then, but Maurice had a plan. He worked with them and developed a sound, a look, and an act. Starr served as the new kids' manager, principal songwriter, record producer, and overall coach. Now Maurice has loosened his grip a bit on the new kids. They're writing and producing some of their own music. But according to industry sources, Starr is part owner in Dick Scott Entertainment, taking 20% of new kids' earnings. Starr also owns Big Step Productions, which earns him 50% of the licensing revenues generated by the new kids' merchandise.
Did you have any idea that they were going to be this big?
I had the idea that they would be this big, yes. But the only thing I did not have the idea about is we would have so many things merchandised. That I did not, I will not lie to you, because there's over 500 different, there's dolls, there's buttons, pins, there's everything, pillows, there's all kinds of stuff. No, I didn't know, but I knew they would be this big.
Critics charge that Starr is exploiting the new kids to make money for himself.
I don't think so. I think the kids are really getting what they want. It's like, of course I've made money, but I'm not one who really even cares about money. You know, the success and the history means more to me.
But Starr hasn't always enjoyed financial success. He grew up here in the rough Roxbury section of Boston, where he and his brothers dreamed of being the next Jackson 5. Maurice idolized Michael Jackson, but Starr and his brothers never made it big.
I was disappointed that I had not made it myself. But I was never a selfish person.
Starr went forward, sharing what he knows about the music business with others. And the success he's had has transformed his life. His roots are still in Roxbury, but Maurice has moved across town. Now he lives in the affluent Brookline area of Boston. Starr's career has been a roller coaster ride. His first success was with the black teenage group New Edition. But after their first big hit, they dumped Maurice, claiming he took too big a financial cut.
That wasn't true at all, because, I mean, a lot of people say that. It was a pretty sizable cut, but I never got the money.
Do you have any bitter feelings or sad feelings about that?
Well, not really. Not really. I think today I'm very happy for him, more than anything. You know, I've been successful. Why should I have bitter feelings? You know, my success is probably 10 times bigger than theirs.
Maurice Starr is easily the most arrogant person I've ever met. When he first came up, he thought he was great. He had New Edition, he thought he was great. New Edition left him, he had a very long down period, he thought he was great. He's got new kids, he thinks he's great. Maurice has always thought he was great. I mean, you know, what can you say about a guy who's got that much confidence?
Of course, we got new kids on the block.
But I think that that Maurice is a talented guy who's aggressively trying to promote himself by building and producing acts much like General Motors produces cars. You know, he's slamming these things together and getting them out in front of the public and hoping they work. He's a manufacturer.
Starr admits that his acts are manufactured. He also admits that raw talent has very little to do with the success of his product.
Oh, yeah. Definitely takes more than talent. And probably the key is probably more marketing and promotion than anything.
Now, Starr is promoting new acts. After all, he realizes new kids won't be around forever. His latest find, 13-year-old Chris Pittman.
If you can give me that. I love
you.
Starr also has Perfect Gentlemen, three young men that include his son and next-door neighbor, and Rick West, a shy 17-year-old who says he's never had any real interest in performing before. But Starr is relentlessly billing him as the next Elvis Presley. These newest kids are just hoping that Maurice's magical touch stays alive. Maurice Starr says not to worry. They don't call him the general for nothing.
Why am I the general?
Because
I'm the man to get the job done.
And Maurice continues to get the job done as we head into the new year. According to Billboard magazine's year-in-review issue, New Kids on the Block had more albums and singles on the charts than any other pop artists. And the boys from Boston...